Welcome to the personalities that are waiting for you for it up tonight to sit down. We have the media, television coming. To welcome our unique guest. Good afternoon, everyone. Good, very hot afternoon, everyone. It's been a long week in the preparation of the Maker Faire Barcelona. Welcome to IAAC. Welcome to Pobla Barcelona. We are in this warehouse in the middle of the Poblenou area, and this week, Alexander is trying to reinvent itself. This is a space of production, of research, of education. Both IAAC and Fabla Barcelona are trying to somehow explore the new boundaries of the use of technology to change, to improve our life and improve the way we live here in this planet. And because of that, we try to bring like the best, I would say, explorers and designers and producers that we can find around the world. And we have become friends of some of them. It's very nice. And some of them are musicians even, which even make it better. I want to start thanking Nadya because I think that a lot of the stuff that we're doing today, tomorrow, and having to do this with Marko because of her and her work and her kindness. But also I want to thank everyone that is joining the major fair for the weekend to come here to the pre-open event. And we're going to have a conference for about an hour, for less. And then concert, live music of the construction band for both Nadya and Marko. And I think that it's a perfect opening for the musical moment to have nervous systems. You can get in with us. I cannot remember very well and pronounce it. I would produce very badly your Latin. So. They're both they're running their positions. The generative design studio based in Boston. They explore the needs of design using new digital tools, both in the digital sphere but also in the physical sphere. You will see that. Their work has been exhibited in the Museum of Modern Art in New York, in the Center Pompidou in Paris, and in some other places that they will sell. And Jessica Pitch is at MIT as well, where she's exploring also with her students new forms of design. And I think that with that, I would like you to welcome them with a warm applause and the stage is yours.
Hi everybody, thanks for having us here at IAAC and at the Barcelona Maker Faire. We're really excited to be here. We are a design studio, I think it's called Nervous System, based in Boston.
You can see our last name.
Rosenkrantz and Louis-Rosenberg, pronunciation not that hard. We founded our studio in 2007, so it started 10 years ago now, so it's still old. And when we started the studio, we were actually both still in school, so we were students. And I was studying architecture and biology, and Dusty was studying math and computer science. And we founded the studio to have a place where we could combine techniques from these very different fields into one design platform.
So our work, a lot of different types of products and mediums. We make kind of everyday products from jewelry to houseware, lighting, jigsaw puzzles, shoes, fashion, and we work with lots of different fabrication techniques and material things from gold and platinum and jewelry to plastic, rubber, wood, but all these different mediums that we're working don't really sort of encompass what we actually do. And our actual medium is more of a computation. So we work by creating software systems that generate designs that are then digitally fabricated.
So many of our design projects start from a natural inspiration. Our project IT was inspired by how being one of these. We started by looking at scientific research about how this process can be modeled computationally. We were really inspired by some research by Adam Arnold at the University of Calgary. We translated his initial idea into an algorithmic system that we could explore the pattern space with and then sort of develop new types of structures.
And when we're working with these sorts of systems, we're not really interested in mimicking nature, but understanding the processes by which forms and patterns are eventually modeled, and then sort of co-opting those for design and using them in unnatural ways, the things that you would not see in here. So, for instance, we started with this initial 2D thing to create structures like leaves, and then extracted that into more of a 3D system, sort of playing with what happens when these structures change through space. And then ultimately, we turned this research experiment into props. So this is a series of one-of-a-kind snap caves called hiking lamps that are 3D printed using selective laser sintering, and kind of just like we use on a tree, every single one is unique.
So in order to produce designs like these that are one of a kind, we need to use fabrication technologies that allow us to produce one of a kind things for the same cost as the better one. Essentially, mass production doesn't work for our design systems. Computer controlled manufacturing techniques like laser cutting and 3D printing are opening up all the new possibilities for how we make things. They make it much easier to make very complex objects. It can be a little bit easy to make this sort of crazy fractal tree thing I have on the screen that's just making cubes. They make it easy to make variations if there's no cost invested in the tools. And they're increasingly all over the place in community fab labs and offices and libraries, even in people's homes. Wow, the slide's already here. However, this is kind of more the dream than the reality. Like, how do you actually create the design you want these machines to make? They can make anything, but how do you instruct them on what you want to make? So part of what we do at Nervous System is explore creating new types of playful design experiences that leverage simulation and web technology to make it possible for anyone to create.
So this is an example of an app that we made in 2010. It's called Cell Cycle, which runs in the browser on WebGL and allows anybody to come and sculpt and play with a cellular form to make jewelry, like ring and bracelets, or you can make more abstract objects that you just like. And it's meant to be kind of a friendly, fun experience, so you don't need a lot of expertise. Anybody can go here and start playing around. You can make small things like just change on size, or you can go into it and subdivide and make patterns. And you can also save and share designs, and then other people can load those and start from your design and fork it, change it. And this is sort of like our one model for how we can create new types of design experiences that engage people that wouldn't have sort of started doing the drawing otherwise.
So our design systems are very inspired by the complex processes that we see in nature. These are processes that grow and adapt to different conditions, and the forms that they decorate, which are diverse and unique, are all just expressions of those processes that created them and the environmental conditions. The idea of form as a process is kind of an interesting counterpoint to how humans generally design things. We often take a very top-down approach where we sort of specify precise measurements and shapes at the beginning of the process, often sort of determining state of the final outcome from the outset. We often talk about using the printer. We also talk about computers offering all these like new ways of making things. However, the software that we have, like Photoshop, which you see on the screen, they also have this kind of weird digital analog of the processes by which these work with physical materials. You think about operations like painting and sculpting and drawing. We have design software that's just like that, that's sort of translated into the computer. Generative design systems, which is how we work, sort of propose a new direction for how we might harness the power of computation to make design software. Nature's process-based approach is really our inspiration. We focus on creating interactive systems so we can interact with. So instead of drawing structures, what we're really interested in is growing them.
So we're going to look have one project in the core form, which is built around this idea of differential choice. So differential growth is kind of this fairly simple idea about how can form and structure emerge in biological systems. If we start with a single cell, everything just grows and divides uniformly, you end up with a uniform block. So how does structure do this? Well, things grow at different rates in different locations, and kind of the interplay between growth and the physics of biological materials leads to form. And how does that sort of control what we're concerned? So one of the most common examples of this is plant surface. The plants can grow, bend, or flight in response to other environmental gradients, like nutrients, or touch. And we do this through a very simple mechanism by growing or elongating differentials. They grow more on one side of the stem than the other side of the stem, and that is and you can do kind of the same thing on the surface. You grow on one side of the surface to the other, and that's the topological shape. And this project began for us when we came across research by a professor at Harvard named Mahadevan, who was looking at another sort of differential growth model, looking at the blooming of flowers like lilies and the shape of leaves. And he's now in a model of differential growth where things grow more towards their edge. And through this kind of simple gradient of growth, you can model the uncurling of petals and the rumbling of their edges. What was interesting about this is that you no longer have this one-to-one relationship between the growth and the form like we do with the bending of a stem, but you get this very complex shape from this very simple rule of three, growing more towards the edge.
So if you look around in nature, you're going to see this all over the place. Look at the edges of flower petals, lettuce leaves, succulents, not only in the plant world though, but kind of all branches of life. You can see this type of growth form, the arms of jellyfish, the form of an anemone, the shape of coral, certain types of mutant cactus, and fungus. So my favorite one is the sea slug. I don't know if any of you have ever seen the sea slug. It's very common in the Caribbean. It's called the lettuce sea slug, Olivia crispata. Basically my favorite animal, so I have to tell everybody about it anytime I have a chance. Tell anybody about it, which is what you guys are right now, is my chance to share this information. You might look at it first, you're like, why is it so crazy? Why could it possibly like need to have all this ornamental useless intractable ruffles on its back? But it does a really cool thing. It travels around coral reefs eating algae. And as it's eating algae, it doesn't just digest them, it steals the chloroplast. That's the part that like turns sunlight into sugar. It rips out the chloroplast of all these algae and it sticks it on the ruffle on its back. So the more surface area it has on its back, the more sort of solar farming area it has. It's like this mobile sea slug farm creature, which really has no relation to anything, but I just had to tell you guys that. So now you know.
Another one of our favorite examples is this flower that in the U.S. is called coxcomb or pelosia. And it has this interesting root mode where on the left is how it grows normally, and on the right is how it's often cultivated through a mutation called fabrication. And the mutation is the growing point of flower to age of emergence, and instead of growing at the point, starts to expand and form a line. And so instead of growing in these kind of branching plume shapes, it forms this sinuous curve that's ever expanding. It's often called the brain flower. And seeing this really is interested in kind of exploring that space of growth. So there's some sort of underlying mechanism where you can flip a switch and change from these branching plumes to these growing rumble surfaces. And could we make a computational system that could explore that space?
So we started to build a system. These are very early models that we built based on kind of a finite element analysis system. We often kind of mull over ideas for many years before we figure out how to implement them and turn them into a project. So we completed these early sketches about 2 years before we revisited this idea and turned it into a project. Basically, ended up completely scrapping the underlying simulation for each of these, starting from scratch.
So we're going to sort of examine some of these basic different workflows that we can have. So this is kind of the base condition of undifferentiated growth. This is just growing the same everywhere. And unlike what you might expect if it just expanded and scaled on top, actually forms this kind of amorphous blob of rainbow. And then we have some different scenarios. The one is a point that grows an expanding line, like the spatiation indication, which might have some type of capacitor. We have a point that splits and then forms branches. So as they split, they grow apart. And then we have an edge base growth, which was our original draping during more so and creating these ruffled forms.
And all three of these models we just look at are on a sort of identical simulation of the same surface, but so different amount of how fast they're growing in different areas. So the red is how fast it's growing, and just by changing the speed of growth in different areas, you can use dramatically different typologies of water.
So this is a little bit of a technical look at sort of the underlying simulation. It's based on a triangle mesh that grows along the edges, so the edges expand. And then as they expand, they subdivide to create more detail in growing areas. There's sort of a collision system around the triangle. It sort of looks like this strange handling ball to prevent it from intersecting with itself. And all of that updates step by step as it grows.
After we've created a generative system like this and kind of established a baseline of growth mode, the next step for us is figuring out how we're going to control it initially. So it's not about just the system growing on its own, but it's about how we can interact with it. So I describe our practice kind of as a form of almost digital gardening, except for instead of growing plants, we're growing algorithms. And ultimately, once we craft these systems, have them in our own innate behaviors. But we want to be able to kind of sort of interact with and help to manipulate those behaviors. So as we're coding our software, we enclose all sorts of influencers and gradients and other types of manipulators that enable us to solve the system. What we're really interested in is that kind of interplay between these behaviors and our interactions with it and what that produces. So some of these things that maybe putting the system can be as simple as changing the stiffness of the material, and other things might be as complex as relationships through time of changing many different parameters. We translated some of our digital experiments into physical things using 3D printing. These are sculptures that we selected with their sintering. The bottom one is a kind of interactive system between our ID project that I showed earlier and the floriform project. And then we've also built kind of devices inspired by 19th century zoetropes on the bottom, where we're kind of illustrating the digital growth process in a physical sculpture. And the colors printed on the surface are actually the growth rates that determine the form you can see.
And then it uses a strobe light to animate the sculpture as they're spinning.
At NeuroSystem, even though it probably sounds like we do weird esoteric research, we're actually really interested in disseminating our ideas and experiments through affordable objects. So we use software that we created to grow the jewelry collection. Each piece that you're seeing now is grown using sort of a specific growth algorithm that we developed for each piece.
And this final piece is are 3D printed once again in nylon using selective urban sintering, also producing sterling silver by 3D printing wax and casting using wall swatch casting.
We're really kind of interested in the possibilities of disseminating sort of complex ideas about research and science and technology into everyday objects. We feel like everyday products embody like complex ideas as well.
Especially when we first started and we were still students, we saw all of these ideas in academia, but they would still rarely leave that world. And we really wanted to make a design studio that would make products for everyday people. So this next project is about jigsaw puzzles, and it sort of takes a very different approach to the previous project. It doesn't start with a national curriculum. Instead, it starts from an interest in traditional craft and harvesting and work. So this is kind of how people know this about IAAC. There are these die-cut cardboard mass-produced bubbles. They have fairly simple repetitive shapes, and they're very cheap, very ubiquitous. And this is how most people know of jigsaw.
However, what you may not know is that jigsaw bubbles actually used to be entirely made by hand. So they date back to the 1800s when the scroll bar was invented. And because each bubble was cut by hand by an artisan, every single bubble was always different. And because the artisan was doing it by hand, they used to develop their own style. The pieces could be much more intricate and complex in their interlocking shapes because there weren't the limitations of having to make a die for hunting cardboard.
And so there were all these different styles. You could see different figure pieces and get it in the bubble, and they're often schematic, something like ship and a ship bubble. And they were really like art objects. And that artistry has kind of been lost in their mass production. So we learned about traditional bubbles and thought they were really amazing and wanted to sort of use new technology and computational techniques to revive that spirit of artistry and traditional puzzles, but in a new way in our own style. So we were first inspired by the extinct animals called ammonites, which have been extinct for millions of years.
Like 100 million years, that's a lot.
And they are a cephalopod like a mollusk. So they live in the shell, and instead of the chambers of the shell being these kind of smooth walls, they look like this image where they make these incredible, just kind of unbelievable shapes. And we thought these would be really interesting interlocking structures that could be used in a jigsaw puzzle. However, ammonites being extinct for 100 million years, nobody really knows how they form or why.
So we started playing around with other things that make similar types of branching patterns. This is a really fun experiment you can do at home. You take your two pieces of glass and you separate them by very thin space. And then if you inject a low viscosity fluid, like water, into a high viscosity fluid, like glycerin, you form these incredible branching patterns called viscous fingering. This experiment is what I call a shock cell. So this is me just playing around with one of these in our studio and looking at these sort of things. They would also make great sweet puzzle pieces.
But we looked into the computational models of this process, and they weren't very promising. They were slow. At some point, when we were first looking at this, like many years ago, the state of the art was growing like some tiny fraction of the types of patterns that we see here in something like 40 hours. And when you're trying to create kind of an interactive design experience, that sort of time scale doesn't really work. So we started to look at other types of phenomena that are similar but have better computational models. So there's this kind of entire class of branching growth, similar to shock cells or certain types of lightning is an example, that's called the Laplacian group. And one of them is this phenomenon called dendritic solidification, which is a crystal growth process that occurs in super cool fluids. And this has a lot of really simple and fast computational models that we work with. So we began to work with that. And we built sort of this puzzle generating system that initializes piece shapes, and then the edges of those pieces are grown in this dendritic solidification system. One of the sort of tricky aspects of this is that all these different phenomena are sort of one thing growing into another. So ice freezing in water or things like that. And in our puzzle world, every single piece grows into each other simultaneously. So there isn't really one thing that forms into another, and you can't, if you try to do that, you're getting complex. So you have to kind of remove a physically realistic element of this process and create a multi-phase model for what you're doing. And this idea kind of makes no sense in the real world, partly because you can't have dendritic meltdown in the same way that you can have dendritic precipitation, but mathematically you can model it all the same thing. And because of that, we can make this sort of incomparable growth simulation to create a couple of things.
So the first series of puzzles we made was called the radial series, and they featured each unique images by an artist named Dawson McGee. You're going to see some of those now, which are incredibly colorful images, and then each one also has a unique cut. So they're all one of a kind broken images by them. So that's kind of very similar to the idea in here of hand testing all puzzles, but basically later, and the algorithm is kind of the first. Kind of felt like we weren't taking it apart. It's still pretty similar to jigsaw puzzles from the 1800s in a way. We started to think about the idea of what can we do with simulation and with laser cutting that would be absolutely physically impossible to do, like if you're doing it by hand. So if you're cutting a puzzle by hand, there's this fact that two pieces basically only go together if you physically cut them apart with a scroll saw. You can't cut things with enough accuracy by hand to make two pieces separately go together.
And this idea was actually originally proposed to us by a puzzle cutter who does puzzles by hand named John Stokes, who is probably the most amazing hand cut puzzle maker in the world. This is one of his works here in puzzles. But he was like, well, one thing that you can never do by hand is make a puzzle that is has pieces sort of scattered into another puzzle. And so, for the idea of wanting to make this extra challenging puzzle, I actually made it for my brother for Christmas to make it something extra difficult. And we made what I call the challenge puzzle, which was a puzzle that has no image, it has no border. You can't really tell the top side from the bottom side because it was just plain wood. And it has this other puzzle embedded inside of it that you can take out and assemble separately.
So with that puzzle, we were starting thinking about making really hard puzzles. And then from there, we just kind of like kept going and thinking, what's the hardest puzzle we could make? And with the challenge puzzle, it kind of doesn't have an edge. Like, there's not a visible edge, and you can't start the pieces and put like the straight ones together first. But there still is kind of an edge to it. It doesn't just go on forever.
And as we do the puzzle, there's actually sort of the three boundary condition within the simulation, where all the pieces that form the boundary have a similar look to them, and as you're doing it, you can quickly identify that, you can use that as a starting point like you do normally with puzzles, and start with the edge.
So we were wondering, like, what would happen if you made a puzzle that really has no boundary at all? Like, on this puzzle, if you look at it closely, you can see, like, the left edge is the same shape as the right edge, and the top edge is the same shape as the bottom edge. So when you put it together, it kind of, like, it has no shape, it has no start, and it has no end, and every time you put them together, it kind of ends up being a different shape. You have to sort of describe it, begin and end to it.
And to do this sort of thing by hand would be extremely difficult. But once again, in the world of computation, I'm creating this sort of simulation is very easy. It's referred to as periodic boundary conditions. It's actually kind of the simplest boundary condition that you have. And so this sort of workflow kind of changes what is possible in making a puzzle. And here you can start to combine multiple copies of the puzzle and create different sorts of color patterns and shapes. And one way you can kind of think about this idea of making a tiling puzzle is thinking about topology. So in topology, you can describe surfaces, closed surfaces, by this idea of a fundamental polygon, which is like this square here. And the idea is, if we have a tiling shape, it's like mapping the left side to the right side, and the bottom side to the top side, and that is equivalent in topology to this one. But there are lots of other weird shapes that we can make in topology by messing with how things are connected. So if instead of mapping one side to the other kind of the same way, you map one side to the other but switch the direction, you're getting sort of strange topological spaces. So this is similar to a Mobius strip or a Klein bottle, where a Klein bottle is a shape that can't really be embedded in normal 3D space, but if you try it, it looks like this. And that's a new property where it doesn't really have an inside or an outside surface. The inside surface flips around and becomes the outside surface, and there's no distinction. So we thought, what if we make a puzzle like this, where instead of just piling straight, it's piled but with a split. And so, similar to a Mobius strip or a Klein bottle, this puzzle has no top side or bottom side. You can take pieces from one side of the puzzle, flip them over, and attach them to the other side. And so you never really know what side is up and what side is down.
We chose an image from the Hubble telescope seen from the puzzle, sort of with the idea that there is some like a puzzle that's sort of supporting the galaxy every time that some of the puzzle get a different shape. And you also get a different picture because you have a different image to see with the possibility lies. I think this project you also make six up puzzles. So we're really interested in kind of thinking about how to apply new technology. In simulation fabrication to all sorts of things, including traditional crafts, like how to make plants and techniques that people have been doing for hundreds of years with these new
techniques. So, now we're going to talk about kind of another angle of our work, which is focused more on customization and digital fabrication. So, kinematic is a perfect that looks at how we can explore fashion and 3D printing. So we started to think about this idea of what is it like to 3D print textiles, which can sound weird at first because 3D printers typically make very solid monolithic materials that are sort of defined by monolithic object, which is sort of the opposite of textile. But when you think about it further, textiles are sort of an interesting thing where their material properties are really defined by how they are distributed in space and how they are constructed by man. Whether a fabric is woven or knit matters much more to its material properties than whether it's cotton or wool. And 3D printing kind of gives us ways of creating even more complex arrangements of material in space. And what sort of things can we do with that that allow us to make materials that have properties that vary through space, whether they have race, or how rigid they are.
Interestingly, computation has a really long history in textiles as well. We were looking at the Jacquard loom, which was first demonstrated in 1801, and it's a machine that used punch cards in order to give intricate instructions for producing richly illustrated fabric. You can think of it maybe as the first computer, or at least like a super important predecessor of the computer. So, kind of a nifty, like long history of computation being involved in producing these man-made constructed materials of fabric. So our project started with just a simple idea for how to make a fabric using 3D printing. Like Justin said, 3D printing normally makes ribbon materials, so we wanted to come up with a way to make something that's sticky and softer, like fabric. So one way to do that is to structure something in a kind of series of interlocking units. So the basic unit of our textile is just hinges connecting together a panel. We made some very small designs like this necklace that you see on the screen because that was like the size of things that fit in our printer. We can print a necklace in one go, that fits in the machine. And immediately we started kind of playing with them and getting a sense of the material properties. And they have like an interesting property where they're kind of soft, but kind of hard. They're not really like a textile with something in between or like a hybrid material. And we really liked that, we thought it was interesting. So I started to dream about making a brick. kind of got to make a huge thing out of this art soft material and see like how that moves and flow and what does that feel like. But I immediately hit a wall. And the problem was how I actually do that. People who want to make something that's big using digital fabrication normally like break down their design into a bunch of small, unique pieces. So if they want to make something like a building and break it down to like 1,000 unique bricks, and then a person has to manually go and organize and assemble those into the correct shape. They sort of took computation and made their life a lot harder. Because before you had 1,000 identical bricks that could go together anyway, now you have 1,000 unique bricks that only go one way. We have like an idea that maybe we can take advantage of the fact that the things we're making are meant to be flexible and use that flexibility to kind of find a smaller shape for the fabrication. So what if we could make a dress like this all in one piece? What if we could use a simulation to sort of shrink it up in the computer before we make it, finding the smaller configuration, shrink it, fold it, and then take it out of the machine and unfold it into a full-scale piece? Then we could, you know, make a dress where it's totally custom fit, but nothing ever has to be cut, sewn, or assembled. So that really like started to get us thinking about making clothing and creating systems for doing this. This is really quite different from how clothing is normally made. Bodies are three-dimensional, they have all this complex curvature, and the way that we make clothes for them is using flat material and flat patterns, which are painstakingly sewn together with a lot of human labor to make something that has a 3D shape. But if we can print it all in one go, then we can sort of have a totally new way to make clothing.
So we had this idea, but it took us about a year to take that idea and actually manifest it as a real object. And we had all these challenges that we had to address trying to make this project a reality. You know, there's issues with how do we print it and material tolerances, strength. Are we going to design these garments? Because what we're really interested in is not just making a one-off thing, but creating an entire system where anybody can engage in the design process and customize their own garment. We also have to figure out how do we actually design on top of your body and how do we incorporate that into a design system. And finally, can we actually simulate these structures and fold them into a small enough shape that they can fit inside a garment?
So the base structure of our textile is pink. Which means that kind of the beginning of our project, we just spent a lot of time designing hinges. What I really wanted to make was a dress, but what we had to make along the way was sort of designing, testing, and typically prototyping dozens of different hinge joints. Part of the issue is that we need to make it as tiny as we can. So the overall movement of the garment is more like a fabric. But the smaller we get, the closer we get to the tolerances that the machine can actually print. Means we're always sort of playing the theme of like, is it going to actually move or is it going to be fused together into a lump?
And you have this issue where, depending on how hot and dense the fill chamber of the machine or the orientation of things are printed in, they come out differently over time. So you try it at least once and it works. You try it again with a larger garment and all of a sudden it doesn't work. So we had a lot of kind of back and forth challenges.
So we decided to start off really small. We designed a necklace and we used our simulation to fold that up into a weird ball of a necklace. We printed that and then unfolded it into a necklace. So that was a success. So we scaled up to something that was actually going to fit a person, which was a challenge. This is a belt. We took a really crappy connect scan of my stomach and then generated a belt on top of that, folded that up and printed it. That also fit. Then we scaled up to something that was starting to look worse than we ultimately wanted to be, so something where we could test the fit and test the durability and the comfort. So this was the first piece we made. It had over 1,000 unique interconnected parts, so all 3D printed at once. This, strangely enough, also worked, which we weren't expecting. So we just kept going from there. One issue, though, is that all the prototypes I just showed you were generated by a software that we made that had no user interface whatsoever. Like, we couldn't see what we were generating, we couldn't, like, design anything about it, but ultimately our goal was to create something where anybody would be able to customize these sort of garments for themselves. So while we were doing that, we were also working on what we see now, which is a cinematic spot, a web-based design app where you can sort of, in real time, design on your body, either on a sort of 3D scan or measurements from your body, a garment to fit to it in your style. We can do things like shaping the hem line and sculpting the shape of the skirt, using structure, the sort of underlying structure of the fabric by changing, painting on these different density of triangles. We can add different aesthetic modules on top of the design we created. And then all of the designs we create can be sort of saved and shared and edited later by other people.
So there was also this issue of body and 3D scanning. So there is sort of this explosion of 3D scanning capabilities that has happened recently. Your phone, or there's Google Tango, a depth camera on the phone to capture 3D data. But 3D scanning tends to be very glitchy and error-prone and difficult to work with. And you get shadows that form on areas that the depth camera can't see or any other sort of scanning thing. And then on top of that, even if you could get a perfect clean scan, you have this whole other problem of how do you understand what that scan is? How do you understand where the waist is, where the hips are, where the cost is, and then create a design system on top of that? And so luckily, while we were working on this entire system, we met a startup that was working on that exact problem. And they're a Circle Body Lab based out of New York. And they created a parametric body model based on machine learning of thousands of scans that could take the measurement or a 3D scan and put out this body that is clean and consistent and built the same over time, such that a point on one person's body maps to the same point on another person's body. And this allows us to use our design system to design a garment for one person and then take that design and automatically map it to another person's body.
So on top of the design system and the physical prototyping, we're also working on a way to do the simulation to fold the garment. The initial idea we had turned out to be very challenging. Can we actually reduce the size of the garment to fret level? Big question. Well, we initially just conceived of crumpling up the garments, like you're wadding up a sheet of paper and tossing it into bin. We do realize that just crumpling things up is not really the most efficient way to fit them in a small space. It's actually way more efficient to do something like you do every day when you're putting away clothing. You fold it neatly and put it away. So we created a tool called Kinematic Fold, which is based on a rigid body physics solver and sort of a series of just straight up collisions with planes and boxes and different surfaces, we're able to reduce the size of our garment by over 85% in a different one box. The neat thing though is we don't just use it to do like efficient things like maybe easier to print. We can also use it to study and understand our garments before we make them. We can look at how they're going to fit and how they're going to move before we actually print these next. We can have a kind of design team between designing a mask and simulating before we make them. So the first dress that we ever made was made about a year after we originally got the idea, and it was actually made for the Museum of Modern Art. We had met Colin Nelly, who's a design curator there, and she had seen a concept video that we showed, which we were looking at. She was interested in potentially acquiring one for the museum collection, which was super amazing. Like, oh my god, the logo, I want to get our work, this is crazy. But I don't know if she knew that we actually had never made it last. It was just a rendering and a concept system. But we told her, like, no problem. We're going to make it and get it to you in time. So at the time of the video is being filmed, it was literally the day before she needed to have it for some meeting that only occurs two times a year. And we were, like, both standing there at the Shapeways Factory in New York, like, really nervous. Like, is the dress going to unfold and be a wearable piece? Or is it just going to be, like, a really expensive lump of plastic? And you kind of can't tell at first, because the way this printing technology works, like with laser sintering, there's this huge nylon powder everywhere that's supporting the garment while it's being made. It has to be like shipping out before anything will move. But we were extremely happy to see that it did unfold, and it was wearable straight out of the machine. And my friend Lana came running from Brooklyn to wear it, so everything worked out, which was great. So, this is our first garment that we made. It is an intricately patterned structure of more than 2,280 pieces interconnected by more than 3,300 hinges. which were all pre-printed as a single piece of nylon. While every component is rigid in aggregate, they kind of have this fabric like movement where they conform to the body and they grow with body movement. Unlike a normal fabric, it's very non-uniform, so we have a textile with varying in its porosity and pattern, also fit. And the thing we're most excited about is it's totally customizable. So you start from your body and your preferences to create something that really fits you.
So since we started this project, we started experimenting with other types of structures. So this is a synthetic pedal dress that's steaming the entire garment in this structure inspired by feathers and pedals that provides us a covering and also an additional customizable element for each one of these pedals you can individually sculpt to the directionality, the size, and shape. We're also interested in applying this kind of design methodology, a design system, simulation, and application method to other sorts of structures, like chainmail structures. So we were invited by Formalab to design a garment for their new SLM trigger for one, which was exciting for us because most SLS printers are extremely expensive. They cost in the realm of $200 to $1 million. And so they're not really something that can be like in a major kit. But their printer is a fraction of that cost. It really brings that technology to a point where maybe it can become something that is more impactful in the world at large. But the problem is that the printer is about 14 times smaller than the printer that we normally print garments on. And so our challenge was, how can we make something that's small enough to fit in their machine? So we immediately thought about printing chainmail. So because chainmail is much less rigid, it has way more degrees of freedom than a kingfish structure, we can actually compress it a lot more. And so we built an entirely new simulation to work with these sorts of structures. And for this shirt, for instance, the bounding box of the initial design, the compressed version is 4% of the bounding box of the original design. And so we were able to fit this entire shirt into a cube that was about 130 millimeters.
So for us, these are like baby steps towards a larger project of thinking about how to really leverage digital fabrication and this idea of co-creation to create new types of digital materials and products. We want to think about taking these techniques beyond making sort of new types of morphologies, but use them to kind of disrupt traditional manufacturing and thinking about how to change the design process through these new techniques. We also are currently working with New Balance, which is a running shoe company in the U.S., thinking about how 3D printing can be applied to performance footwear. Can we use additive manufacturing to make shoes that fit better or allow you to run better? This is a question that apparently all shoe companies are extremely excited to research. Towards this end, we've been working on printing midsoles using the new CPU elastomer material for SLS.
So this is sort of a bit of a departure from our normal process in that it's really working a lot with data. So normally we're mostly interested in interactive processes or in kind of growth systems. But their focus is really on capturing different types of data from runners and how can we use that in the design process. So this is an example of pressure data from a runner. This is a series of sensors in insole and outsole of the shoe and shows how those the shoe impacts the ground and the foot impacts the shoe. But they're also interested in lots of other types of data, from 3D scans to seeing high-speed video where they can measure of how much your foot is stretching as you run, and how we can use that to design shoes and maneuver.
So we looked at, we're currently looking at many different ways to translate this data into sort of space filling through sensible structures. Some of these experiments are very focused on the function of the midsole, adapting it functionally to the data, and others are focused more on the aesthetics, how can we visually convey a person's data to the customer. The system we're currently working with is a system for generating anisotropic bone structures. It's very inspired by looking at the types of cellular ladders that we see in bone and wood. These are ladders that are really responding as they grow to stress and environmental conditions to provide more structure and support where it's needed. So here's two midsoles generated by an early version of the system that show different support structures created for two different types of runners. The person on the right lands on their heel. The person on the left lands on their midfoot, which is a common running style. And their data results in the shoes that are optimized for their performance in different ways.
So this is really an ongoing collaboration for us. There's a new balance to kind of leverage 3D printing both to pair that is perhaps more performant or more personalized to your running style, but also to kind of change the entire way that shoes are manufactured. Your shoes are kind of the traditional mass-produced process. Each one of these midsoles is a section molded and different sizes and styles. It's like hundreds and hundreds of molds that need to be created. And this really changes that entire manufacturing process to be able to make each one individual.
So thanks everybody for listening to us tonight. We've been trying to show you a little bit about our interest in nature and simulation and digital fabrication, and that's led us on this weird adventure of jigsaw puzzles that you can never finish and dresses that you can wear every day by robotically controlled machines. Like pieces of weed. But ultimately, as you can tell, we're just two weird, nerdy people who really like making things and learning. So if you want to get in touch with us, you can reach out to us on our website or on Twitter, and we'd love to hear your questions if you have any now, or just talk to you later tonight, because I think there's a concert coming up, so maybe we don't have time for questions. Thanks.
Thank you. Tomorrow we're going to have both of them a debate. Today with Nadya is a very fan about the technology at the maker server for us. So we're going to keep that. But now we're going to have a moment. It's a pleasure to introduce the construction class, which you guys can see. This form followed by Marko Ahtisaari and Nadya. So Nadya is a director of technical business at MIT. Marko is a technology entrepreneur and teacher of electronic opportunity at MIT. And I would love to invite you to the stage and set up. And you can, in the meantime, if you get to the stage, you can get a beer. Follow Marko or Alice or in Canada, they're going to open one of the beer stages and construction stages in the public. Thank you. What is velvet? Sound velvet. Also, it would be great if you help us to take a chair out of the way. We're going to start.
Yeah.